Across Australia, those simmering tensions across the country with Jewish and Palestinian communities here on edge amid the Middle East conflict. In Melbourne's southeast, an extra 60 police officers have been deployed after that ugly clash in Caulfield last Friday.
In another scary incident, a woman has been filmed in South Yarra trying to remove an Israeli flag from a cyclist before he was set upon by two men. In the meantime, in New South Wales, the government is moving to tighten laws against hate speech, threats and incitement to violence.
And now students are planning a walkout from classrooms across Melbourne to support Palestinians. For that, we cross to Today Melbourne reporter Christina Hearn. Chris, what are students planning?
Well, Carl, the strike for Palestine is being planned by students for November 23. So the plan is for them to walk out of the classroom at 12:30 and then gather here in the city for a rally at 1:30. Student activists have reportedly targeted schools in the inner city, but also say that students from across the state have shown interest. This has only just been announced, this rally, but already it has sparked quite a bit of debate. The Federal Education Minister, Jason Clare, says the place for students in school is in school during school hours, while the Shadow Education Minister Sarah Henderson says that students should not be used as political pawns by either groups. Already in Melbourne, tensions have been running really high over the past couple of weeks. Last Friday, there was a really ugly clash in Caulfield between the two opposing sides. And then on Sunday, we had a man that was cycling on busy Chapel Street with an Israeli flag assaulted. As a result, Victorian political and religious leaders have called for calm, while police say they are going to be upping patrols in areas which have got increased protest activity. Carl?
Chris, thank you.
The federal government is this morning welcoming a trade revolution in the form of sweeping changes to defence export laws that will establish the military equivalent of a free trade zone with the UK and the US. The changes are designed to allow for sharing of sensitive technology through AUKUS while protecting them from nations including Russia and China. After nearly a week, it's finally been brought to light what sparked the Optus outage, which hit 10 million Australians and 400,000 businesses. The company says a routine software update accidentally disrupted phone and internet services, causing the blackout. The telco now faces a $400 million compensation bill, and the CEO will face a Senate inquiry on Friday. Major port operator DP World is resuming operations following that massive cyber attack, but more potential disruptions are looming. Today, senior reporter Jack Hahn joins us now from Port Botany with that story. Jack, good morning. Workers are now walking off the job.
Yeah, certainly not smooth sailing just yet for DP World, even though their terminal operations are getting back to normal here in Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane and Perth this morning. The cargo company is now working to move the more than 30,000 shipping containers that were storing everything from clothes to technology products, supermarket food, even blood plasma. They were all caught up in this crippling cyber attack over the weekend. But as you pointed out, DP World is now facing looming industrial action with workers walking off the job on Friday for 24 hours. That will further disrupt our country's fragile supply chains with Christmas around the corner. Brooke.
Okay, thanks, Jack.
Well, 7 years after standing down as British Prime Minister, David Cameron has this morning been parachuted back into politics. Europe correspondent Brett McLeod is following the story. Brett, good morning. He's Rishi Sunak's new Foreign Secretary.
Yes, quite the retro move, Sarah, being pulled by Rishi Sunak in a big cabinet reshuffle. But it's fair to say that when David Cameron was spotted walking into Downing Street a few hours ago, no one expected what was about to come, that he would be returning to government for the first time since he left as Prime Minister in 2016 and taking up the very important role of Foreign Secretary. They have to make room for him in Westminster. He's now Lord Cameron, but he won't be facing scrutiny in the House of Commons. Quite a significant shake-up, perhaps a signal too that the Sunak government is moving more towards the centre. The biggest loser in the cabinet shake-up, well, that was Suella Braverman, the very outspoken, often controversial former Home Secretary now, whose comments ahead of the pro-Palestinian march at the weekend are being blamed by police for some of the violence. She's also under attack for her earlier comments saying that homelessness is a lifestyle choice. As one MP said, she's now discovering that unemployment can be a lifestyle choice too. Sarah?
All right, Brett, thank you.
A driver has been treated by paramedics after a two-vehicle crash in Western Sydney overnight. Police say a Volkswagen van collided into the rear of a stationary work truck on the Western Motorway in Maryland just before 11 o'clock last night. None of the road workers were injured, but the van's 42-year-old driver was taken to hospital for observations. Police are this morning on the hunt for a pair of armed, masked bandits who broke into a Queensland home and threatened a mother with an axe. The young homeowner only moved into the Townsville property 2 weeks ago and was home with her 18-month-old baby when the incident took place. The victim was only left with minor injuries to her leg. Police have charged a man with several offences after he allegedly threatened a tugboat crew with a firearm in waters south of Perth. Officers say the 48-year-old then crashed his dinghy into authorities at Kwinana Beach before being arrested a short time later. Granted bail, he'll reappear in court next month. Police are hunting for two men accused of stealing $6,000 worth of fuel and crashing their truck in Sydney's west. The pair fled after their truck rolled on the M7 at Horsley Park on Monday morning with three tanks filled with diesel.
A Gold Coast homeowner has been run over by a group of teens he chased out of his home. Let's go live to Nine's Bailey Kenzie in Robina. Bailey, talk us through what happened.
Yeah, Carl, good morning to you. This really is an incredibly frightening ordeal and one that left homeowner Ben Holland battered, bruised and with what he says is a broken rib. This all unfolding at 3.30 in the morning on Sunday morning. This group of teenagers attempting to break into his Robina home on the street behind me when he was woken by his wife and his dog, Chili, confronting what he says is three teenage boys and a teenage girl. When he confronted them, he was mowed down by what police say was a stolen car, a second car involved an SUV, then attempting to do the same. Now, meantime, fresh this morning, new CCTV has emerged of teenagers matching the exact description of those that Ben say attacked him over at Mermaid Beach, casing out another home and attempting to break inside a BMW. Speaking yesterday, Ben says he's been left incredibly terrified that these teenagers could return again.
They were quite happy to run me over to get away. So what are they willing to do to somebody else? It scares me, the fact that they could do it to somebody who's not as big and they'd kill them.
Carl, this morning these teenagers still do remain on the run. Police are appealing for anyone with new information or vision to come forward.
Bailey, thank you.
South Australian schools have cancelled all ocean-based aquatic activities after recent shark attacks in a move slammed by the state's surf life-saving body. SA schools say the decision is underpinned by the safety of students and staff, but Surf Life-Saving has condemned the knee-jerk reaction, saying it will make kids unnecessarily scared of the water. The skyrocketing value of the average Aussie home loan has led to calls home ownership has become the preserve of the rich. Speaking to News Corp, ANZ boss Shane Elliott says, quote, if you want a loan, you have to be better off and essentially rich. The comments come as the average mortgage soars to almost $600,000, which is around $250,000 more than a decade ago.